Hello, everyone, and welcome to this week's edition of The Extra Point. I'm here again once with Callie.
There you go.
And Zach. You
got your directions right.
Got it right.
Yay, for being right.
We appreciate you guys joining in. First, it wasn't a great week for football in Tennessee, but we're going to start this off, and you'll kind of see a little bit of a trend as we go. Of course, last week, Tullahoma lost 42-28 to Nolensville. Coffee County lost 41-9 to Oakland. Franklin County lost 48-13 to Summit. However, Moore County won. Yeah, there's a winner out there. Lincoln County lost. Huntland lost. Shelbyville won. Grundy County won. And Fayetteville lost. Let's talk briefly about that Franklin County game. Go ahead, Callie. Fill us in.
Well, you know, like I said, Franklin County had their work kind of cut out for them with Summit coming in. You know, they Summit having probably, again, one of the best seasons it's had in its football program under Brian Coleman. You know, he's a student of Mac. He coached under Mac, so it's kind of like master versus student that game, and the student won. But, you know, they're just a more experienced ball team and showed as much. A lot of ball control, shut down our run, and we just couldn't get anything going in the pass. And we had some turnovers, which always, you know, will kill you in a game. I do have to give credit to the Franklin County team. God, I can't believe I'm going to use this word, but for the resiliency. And they are. I mean, they're a growing football team. They're learning, and this is still a very young crew, and they stay resilient throughout the game. And they're also, you know, this is the middle of your season. You're dealing with some injuries, and you're still got – you know, the rest of the season to go. So this is a tough point in the season for all the football teams right now, as to kind of getting that second wind and finishing out. So it was a tough loss, and we go to Columbia this week, which I think will also be a tough game for Franklin County.
Don't be getting into my next week game.
Pardon me.
Well, we kind of all figured that Coffee County was going to lose to Oakland, and they did. Lost 41-9. The road gets taller to climb, or the wall gets a little bit higher. But you know, the one thing is that they're in the playoffs.
Yeah, I mean, they're automatically assured because of the new divisions are set up. So
yeah,
Coffee County is already automatically assured. Even if they were to go 0-10, which they already notched a win on the season, so they're going to finish 1-9. But they're guaranteed that playoff spots. So.
All right. Well, Moore County won. That was good thing. I think we all kind of expected maybe they could pull a victory off. And so far they're having a pretty good season. I don't remember what the record is on the season, but it might be 6-2 at this point, or 5-2.
I'll tell you in just a second.
Let's talk. You know, I noticed you tweet a lot during the Tullahoma games.
And yeah, stuff I do out the live scoring updates. Yeah, it's become available.
It's hard to get down 28-0. And dig yourself out of that hole you've dug. So this seems to be a reoccurring nightmare for the
Yeah, that's one guys. Of my questions for Coach Howell after that game is, this is 3 games out of 7 games where you guys have entered halftime down by 20-plus points. You know, what is it about the first half that you guys aren't – what is it? Why don't you guys come out ready to play? His answer was, he didn't know if his team can handle pressure very well. You know, the first time they were down 20 points at a halftime was in the Coffee Pot game, obviously a pressurized situation. Then next time they're down by 20 points is their first home opener whenever they host Franklin County. Or not their first home opener, but whenever they face Franklin County. So he doesn't know if his team is ready to deal with that pressure. So, but he's got them ready to play in the second half, so they just need to put two halves together.
Yeah. Well, I mean, usually it's the – You lose a game in the second half, usually in football.
Exactly.
You know? So the better team wins the game in the second
half. It's sort of a weird phenomenon that's going on with Tullahoma. What's really plagued Tullahoma the last 2 seasons is they just didn't have
– Was it turnovers again this game?
Not really, and that was the thing too. Tullahoma only turned the ball over once, and that resulted in a touchdown for Nolensville. But, I mean, at that point you get the touchdown, then it's 21-0, and they add one more to make it 28. But – turnovers didn't really play a huge factor. It's not converting on opportunities for Tullahoma. That's really hurting itself. It did that against Spring Hill, having their first drive of the game that they marched down to about the 11-yard line. throw a pick in the end zone. This week they marched down to the 2-yard line. Can't punch the ball in the end zone because they get backed up with penalties. So it's just it's those little tiny stuff that'll set drives back that is setting Tullahoma back.
Execution. All right. With that being said, let's move on to this week's games. Maybe we talk briefly. We'll go to Cali since you already told us that Franklin County would be at Columbia this week. So what do you see in that game? Tough game?
Tough game. Road game.
Game they can win, though.
I think it's a game they can win, but I think they've definitely, as in with Summit, they've definitely got their work cut out with them. Columbia Central is having a really good year this year.
Can they make the playoffs if they win this game?
No, I don't know. I don't know how many wins you have for the
– You just got to finish in the top four.
Okay, well, they're still working on that. They're 4-2 on the – they're 4-3 on the season, so this is a big game for them to really kind of get back some momentum as they go, because we play Shovel, or we play Lincoln County, then Shovel after that. Two big rivalries for Franklin County, so this win would really help kind of
– Well, they need it.
They need it.
Shovelville's going to be a tough game. Lincoln County is a little bit down.
But they'll still play them hard. You know, these are rivals, so they're going to play them hard regardless. But, you know, yeah, like I said, they're a very resilient team. If I've ever seen a team –
This could be the make-or-break game.
Yeah.
To make the playoffs.
It is. I really feel like this is a huge make-or-break game for them.
You know, making the playoffs, we know Coffee County's in, but I haven't really looked at Lebanon's record.
He has won 5 games on the season.
I don't know if you've looked at Lebanon's record this year.
But
Lebanon at Coffee County, that might be a game that Coffee County can win. Lebanon's not been notoriously a strong
program. Yeah, it's going to be a close game, but I still think Lebanon, I think they're going to be able to beat Coffee County. Just my general prediction, seeing what I've seen from Coffee County. So I think Lebanon will win that probably in a close game.
I know. It's like you can hear his.
Yeah,
you can hear his. Exactly.
Moore County's on a bye this week, and we'll talk Lawrence County at Tullahoma. We've got Lawrence County coming to Tullahoma. It is a game at Tullahoma.
It is a game that Tullahoma can win. Lawrence County's been struggling this year. Of course, last year, Lawrence County and Tullahoma were struggling as well, and Lawrence County ran all over Tullahoma. So, you really – this is an important game for Tullahoma. This has a huge playoff implication as well. Tullahoma has never won a region game to this point. All 3 games that they won this season have been out of region play. So, after last Friday's game – Coach Olive told me that he desperately wants this one so bad. And this is a team that Tullahoma has not beat since 2012.
Oh, wow.
Prior to that winning streak that Lawrence County put up, Tullahoma had a 19-game winning streak over Lawrence County. So
yeah.
It's one of those rivalries that goes back and forth. But this is a win that Tullahoma desperately needs. If it wants to have any chance of making the playoffs, they are going to have to win this game and get their first region win ever.
Good luck. Hopefully they'll do that. Let's talk about other games this week. Huntland at Grace Christian. You know, they had an unfortunate loss at homecoming last week and lost. Nolensville will be at Lincoln County. Grundy County will be at Cascade. Warren County will be at Fayetteville and Summit. Will be at Shelbyville. Shelbyville will have a tough game this week.
Oh, yeah.
All right, before we move on, let's shout out to any locals real quick.
Well, I'll go ahead and start, and then you can follow me up on this.
Sure.
So North Middle School beat South Middle School, big rivalry, in a 14-8 win, which sets them up too, and then you can hand the baton.
Well, yeah, Tullahoma ended up, the middle school football team ended up defeating Harris last night 44-14, which locked them into the CTC championship game, which we played at the old Franklin County High School field against North at 10 a.m. on Saturday morning.
Oh, cool.
So it'll be a
Thanks, Missy Cox, for
listening to
us.
For watching our program.
So 10 o'clock on Saturday, that middle school championship game will set up. And then I also wanted to give a huge a little shout-out to the THS soccer team, who opens its district tournament on Sunday. They'll host Central Magnet at 6:30 p.m. over at East Middle School. So come out, check out some good soccer.
Also, come out next Tuesday at Johnson Lane Soccer Complex at 6 p.m. Motlow will be playing a home game. I can't remember the team they're playing against, but if you want to go watch some college soccer, go out and support the Bucks.
Very cool to have college soccer.
There'll be a lot going on. There's going to be a lot of kids. Of course, a lot of practices will be going on, but some of them will move to go watch the soccer game, of course. Let's talk picks. College picks. Last week, why did we have to talk last week? Well, you didn't do too bad last week. We all went 4-2 last week. Overall, I'm 19-12, still in the lead. Zach, you were close behind at 17-14. And Callie, you were bringing up the rear at 14-17. Before we go to the picks, let's talk college football. It was an embarrassing loss to Georgia last week. Here's my two cents, and you guys can add it. Yeah, if you're competitive, it's okay.
Yeah.
All right. We figured the Vols were going to have a little bit of a down season this year. They weren't even competitive in this game.
No.
I thought it was embarrassing. They're not getting the ball in their playmakers' hands. If they are, their playmakers aren't getting the job done. How long does Butch Jones have it? Things keep going the way they're going.
He's pretty much a dead man walking at this point, if you believe all the media reports.
I think, though, he has one saving redemption, and that is in South Carolina. That's not going to happen. He has to come back in 2 weeks, and he has to beat South Carolina. If he doesn't beat South Carolina, then he's all but done.
I think it's got to be a convincing win.
Oh, I agree.
Yeah, because it just can't be a squeaker that you know, winning 17.
And we're going to talk more about Butch Jones here in a minute because, you know, there was somebody else that had suffered another embarrassing loss in college football.
Yeah.
But I think, and I want to say really super fast, that the players really need to be supportive of the players. I don't think, you know, and Kurt Herbstreit had a very good quote about how we have individual talent right now. And what we're really needing to say from these guys is some cohesiveness. We really need some leadership emerge in the next few weeks.
You know, Butch Jones doesn't 100% just coach the team. He coaches the whole program.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So but you said a standard coaches, for stuff. It's the coaches like that. Yeah.
You know, it's the like you said, the gel, the cohesiveness, you know, is everything flowing. So, you know, he's not even really calling plays, I would say.
You know, I'd like to know how much exactly I've heard that he has a lot of say over the offense and what the play calling in the offense. I would like to ask that question and find that out, just how much he has.
All right, so we know Tennessee's that bad so far this year. Is Alabama that good?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, they have totally annihilated the last two teams they've played.
Yeah, they're – probably the most sound team I've seen on both sides.
In college football.
Yeah. I mean, I have yet seen it.
Auburn had a pretty impressive win last week.
They did, and Auburn has a really stout defense. Thing that about Auburn that still raises some questions is their offense. How good is it really? Obviously, they put up 44 points on Mississippi State.
Might make that Iron Bowl very interesting.
Yeah, it'll be interesting for a little bit, but I think Alabama's still far above them at this point.
So all right. So Alabama is that good?
I believe it. Yeah. I mean, it's more. Nick Saban is like the numbers guy of football. He's like the ultimate businessman. He can look at every player on his team, and he can tell you just how much he can get out of that player, percentage wise. And he will go to that player and say, "I know what I can get out of you. This is what you're going to have to put in." There were ever a numbers man in football, Nick Saban.
Well, it's probably not a bad way to do it because it's like if you're not doing this, then this guy behind you steps up.
It's
just like the epitome. When someone gets injured, someone has to step up and fill that position. Now, they may not do it as great, or maybe they do it better, but they have to step up and do that. And that's what you need in a leader on a team.
Yeah.
And you're not just a coach. You are a leader.
You know? Yeah. Well, you're setting those standards. You know, you create that culture. He talks about resiliency. He talks about being champions of life. He talks about consistency.
You're talking about Butch saying it.
Okay. So you talked about we need to see it.
Yes.
And there hasn't been any consistency other than the consistency of poor play calling, poor clock management. And now he seems to have lost his players. You know, so, and that's another.
And he's not losing his fan base, too.
Well, yeah. I mean, but fans.
Fans
are fickle. Thank you. Any fan, people in general are fickle. So I don't even really worry about the fans. It's the players. Because if you play consistently, you're going to shut the fans up.
but today's social media and stuff, the players see what the fans
and that's
are saying.
Where they and that's where they yeah. that's where social media has been, I think, a detriment to college football.
Well,
or to
sports
in general.
It's a detriment
to society.
To society.
Yeah, well, in society, yes. Yeah.
I mean, it didn't take more than the few hours after the Las Vegas shooting that, you know, propaganda was coming
out. Oh, absolutely.
About
what
could have or what possibly happened. I mean, it's just, it's a pariah. All right. Speaking of it, is that good? LSU paid Troy almost $1 million. It was $900,000+.
$985,000, I think. They should get asked for that $15,000.
To come, to come to Baton Rouge to beat them.
Yes.
Now, do you think LSU is kind of wishing maybe they had less miles now?
Well, absolutely.
I never understood the why he was thrown under the bus to begin with. And you have a coach that obviously you struggled some, but you've had this guy at helm for a while. Why not let him ride him out? You guys aren't that – they weren't that bad last year.
No.
They just didn't have an offense last year.
I mean,
and
Tennessee at this point would take several 9-2 seasons.
Exactly.
Tennessee would love to have that defense that LSU had last year.
Yeah.
Or some 10-2 seasons. You know,
but,
I'll take three 10-2
seasons.
Again,
with Fickell fans.
I know, it's Fickell fans and LSU fans that have been Fickell for a while. Because
same reason why Mark Richt had to go, because they weren't winning enough in their opinion.
No. I'd take Mark Richt at this point.
Oh, I'd take Mark Richt in a heartbeat.
If he can recruit
Hollis.
And coach, I'll take some 10-2 seasons. Yeah. Give me about 10 years of 10-2, and then I'll start
complaining
about not having a national championship. All right, speaking about embarrassing losses that we've already talked about, and, you know, Butch Jones being on, or even LSU's guy now, I'm sure he's on the hot seat, although I doubt he's on the hot seat as much as Butch Jones.
His payout's too much.
But who's out there? Are there even any coaches out there? So it's like,
John Gruden.
He's not
his name's always
that.
I know. I was kidding.
I mean, the only one that I can think of is Les Miles. But they already have Vegas has odds on Butch Jones.
And Chip Kelly's the leader right
now. I wish people would quit saying Chip Kelly.
Me too.
I don't think it's
the SEC.
I don't think it's
you want to know?
Dan
Mullen's already talked about being ready to move on. So that name is out there. But I want to put this in everybody's ear. Jim Bob Cooter, who is the offensive coordinator at Detroit Lions.
Yeah.
He would make an excellent head football coach at Tennessee. Not only does he know his offense, which we're in desperate need of, but he is a hometown boy. If you think about your past Tennessee coaches who have been successful at Tennessee, Johnny Majors from
Bill Fulmer
from Franklin County, Jim Bob Cooter is from Lincoln County. I just think for recruiting and everything, it would be just it's my dream choice.
Peyton Manning,
No, Peyton Manning.
Yeah,
Peyton
I wouldn't Manning. Want to see Peyton that.
You wouldn't want to see him come back here and fail, too, though.
No, I don't
want to see him fail. It's just too much.
I just want to see his experience before, you know. He has no coaching experience.
Yeah.
You know, he's got all the on the field stuff, but you want to see somebody out there coach.
The guy from Louisville,
Bobby Petrino.
Bobby Petrino, he's up there.
I think it's sort of the whole question mark with Louisville right now going on, and, you know, his past in Arkansas,
he's still got that stench on him a little bit. Hey, I'll take a little stench to get to the Tennessee season.
No, and somebody said the other day that we could pay Dan Mullen's Butch Jones.
Lane Kiffin's name.
No.
Yeah, I've heard that one.
Tennessee's problem is that we haven't invested any time into actually finding a coach that fits the program. We've just tried to put a warm body in there as fast as we could, and we are now winding up paying for it. Nobody wanted to put any time into actually their coaching decision. We threw Lane in there.
Steve Spurrier's from Tennessee.
Yeah, but he's not coming back to coach. As much as I would love that, no.
All right, well, let's move on to this week's picks. All right. You guys understand what I wrote down here about a stupid underdog pick?
Yeah.
All right. So then, Callie, we'll start with you. Number 23, West Virginia is going to TCU. I think TCU's ranked.
Yeah, TCU is ranked.
Yeah, pretty high.
Who do you think is going to win this one, Callie?
TCU.
Callie's taking TCU.
Oh,
I'm taking TCU because they're at home.
Well, me too. TCU has beat Arkansas earlier this year, which is insane, a whole bunch. But, I think TCU is a pretty good team on both sides of the ball.
Pick from a couple of weeks ago that wound up getting canceled, and I'm not going to go back and hold you to your picks. Miami is at FSU now. You know, it is at FSU. FSU's been struggling. but Miami really hasn't played anybody yet, so we don't know how really good they are. So what do you think, Zach?
I'm going with Miami in this one. I think Florida State is struggling with the
loss. I'm with him on this.
And I think Mark Richt wants to get a signature win.
This is a huge rival for the ACC, and I think Miami also takes the win.
I think based on Mark Richt needing that signature win, the team's going to be fired up. I think it's going to be a lot closer because FSU, this is a big game for FSU because this would be three losses.
Yeah.
And they've only played four games, five games. Yeah. Would be the worst start they've probably ever had. So, but I'm going to take Miami, although I think FSU could pull – that could be a stupid underdog.
Yeah, it could be a stupid underdog.
LSU at Florida. If you'd asked me a week ago, I would have said, oh, LSU's going to beat them. Every time I've gone against Florida, it seems like for some reason, somehow, they do some miraculous catch or something. So, Zach, what do you think?
I'm going with Florida in this one. I just think LSU is still trying to find itself after last week getting knocked out by Troy.
I'm going to even – you know I can't pick Florida, so I got to go with LSU.
I refuse to pick them.
You know, and I think that LSU could beat Florida because after the embarrassing loss last week, somebody's butt got chewed out, and LSU needs to come out and prove this. I'm actually going to go with Cali on this week.
Oh, wow. I'm just doing it because I'm not picking Florida. I just refuse to pick them.
I actually feel like LSU can win. Arkansas at South Carolina. South Carolina struggled. Arkansas struggled. Cali, what do you think?
Oh, God.
Home team?
I think home team. It's at home. They've proved that they can pull it out at the last minute kind of deal. As much as I'd love to see Will Muschamp lose, I just don't feel like it. Arkansas can pull it off.
See, I want Arkansas in this one.
He needs to win.
South Carolina has struggled so much first two games of the season, and hasn't been consistent. So I'm going Arkansas in this one.
I see a little more consistency with Arkansas than I do with South Carolina. I think it would be a close game. However, I think Arkansas's ground game, I think South Carolina's really struggling.
Yeah.
I think they're really struggling. So I'm going with Arkansas. We'll say probably the game of the week for last. Kansas State at Texas. Zach, you're a Texas boy.
I am a Texas boy, and I don't particularly root for the University of Texas, but I do think they'll get this win. I think Tom Herman is one of the best coaches at getting his teams to play two higher opponents, and obviously Kansas State was predicted to be one of the top teams in the Big 12 this year. I lost to Vanderbilt earlier this year, but I think this is a game that Tom Herman and Texas really needs, so he will have his players fired up for this game, so I'm going Texas.
I agree.
It's hard to tell what you get with Texas.
Yeah, it is hard to tell.
Yeah, play USC, Carson.
I'm going to go with Texas. They're at home. I think the home team is going to win that game. All right, Louisville to number 24, NC State. NC State is in the – has cracked the top 25. So, number 17, Louisville at NC State. Can NC State pull this off?
I go with Louisville on this one. Although they, been kind of hot and cold at some point, I still think that they get this win. Although I think it'll be a close game.
Yeah, I think it'll be a close one. NC State has a good defense. The only thing that's been questioning them in the last couple of years that I've questioned from them is their offense. So I'm going Louisville on this one. I think Lamar Jackson's just going to have that playmaker ability and just make a little bit more plays.
I think NC State keeps this game close, and the ball goes into Louisville's hands with about a minute left in the game, and Lamar pulls out the victory. I'm going with Louisville. Watch it go out. All right, stupid underdog pick. Okay, this is where you take somebody that's maybe not ranked, playing a ranked team, and you think you this will not count against you. All right, so if you got a game in mind, I think Maryland has a chance to beat Ohio State. Do you think you're crazy?
I don't think you're crazy at all.
Think you're necessarily crazy. I think there's a chance they could. Obviously, Maryland beat Texas earlier this year, but I still think there's a low percentage of it happening. I think Maryland being down to its third-string quarterback, which still performed well last week, but I still think having that depth.
I don't care. That's my pick. Well, who's your pick?
Can I pick anyone even from our picks that we made this week?
Sure.
I'm going to say Arkansas, South Carolina.
Oh, this is their stupid underdog.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, well, I just feel like I'd really like to see Arkansas pull off a win against South Carolina.
But you took, so you're going to say Arkansas.
Arkansas beats South Carolina.
Although you picked South Carolina.
Well, it's a more logical choice in the end of that. And since I picked LSU, well, it is.
Let's move on to Zach.
Oh, we're doing stupid.
No, South Carolina beating, because they're at home. But if I could have anybody upset, it would be Arkansas against South Carolina.
I guess if I'm picking my underdog pick, I think LSU beating Florida would be the underdog pick at this point.
Yes, they are an underdog pick.
Has Florida's luck run out?
I thought a good game was out there was Oregon was playing. Michigan was playing. Michigan State was playing Michigan.
Oh, yeah. That'll be a close game, though, for some reason, I think, because they always play each other hard.
You know, Michigan's ranked high. Michigan State's being a little bit underlooked. But anyway, moving on. I put something out there. I was kind of utterly embarrassed to be a Tennessee football fan. Mm-hmm. All right?
Yeah.
The Titans being the Vols, MTSU losing, Vanderbilt losing. Is it the same old time? I mean, they got crushed. Did they give up? It looked to me like they gave up.
Their defense gave up.
Exactly. The whole team gave up. The whole team gave up. Once it got to be like at halftime, it was 28-14. They came down and scored again. They were getting the ball back, came down and scored again. The game was over.
Yeah, I think the most notable thing from this game is obviously Mariota getting injured. That's a huge thing. That's a huge deal for the Tennessee Titans moving forward. And not only that, it's I think this is the bigger deal for the whole AFC and NFL in general, is that the Texans finally have found what seemingly looks like a quarterback. You know, that's been the one thing that Texans fans lived in Houston and had to hear Texans fans moan every year about them not having a franchise quarterback. Well, Deshaun Watson looks like the real deal.
Oh, yeah.
Putting up 57 against Tennessee and playing a close ball game against the Patriots two weeks ago. So, looks like Texans have finally found their quarterback at this point. So, that's a huge deal for the AFC and for the NFL.
Well, and, you know, you speak of Mariota's injury. I mean, he's been a little injury-plagued. Is he the Titans' quarterback? I mean,
you'd hope so.
I mean, he had a great run.
You'd hope he's just not another Jake Locker, you know, John Locker ended up having to retire due to too many concussions. So you hope things don't end up the same way with Mariota, and you hope that he's able to get healthy. Hopefully his injury doesn't keep him out.
Well, you know, I kind of wondered about his injury. Was it to the point they just said, hey, this game's out of control, there ain't no sense of putting him back in?
Maybe, but and then you look at what's going on this week where they're about to sign, or if they haven't already, they're looking at Brandon Weeden signing him. So it's –
maybe it's more extensive than
– Yeah, yeah.
So, well, and that's going to go back to being a playoff contending team to being the first round draft.
This is not looking well for the Titans at this point, but who knows? Maybe Mariota will get back quick, and
we'll see.
We'll see.
All right. Well, I know they have I can't remember if they go to Miami or if Miami's coming here, but they have Miami's struggling a little bit.
Yep.
But I don't know. All right, we're about getting on to 30 minutes, so we need to move on. Predators hockey. Predators drop the puck tomorrow on their new season. Our Stanley Cup. Not champions, I thought.
Stanley Cup runner-up.
But anyway, they drop the puck tomorrow night against the Boston Bruins in Boston. Then Saturday, they travel to Pittsburgh.
Oh, you think they didn't circle that one?
They travel to Pittsburgh against the Stanley Cup champions. And quite honestly, if you go back to Stanley Cup, I thought they got a little robbed by the referees.
Oh, yeah.
Game one notably comes out that offside penalty that would have put the Predators up one.
Well, and then I thought there should have been a penalty. On the team in game one. And you go back to game six when they scored, they took the goal away from
them. That's what I meant. Yeah. The goal away on the offsides. Yeah.
So, anyway, if you get a chance, I just actually heard something on the radio today that they're going to have $15 tickets available on game days.
Okay.
So I'm sure they won't be the greatest seats, but for $15.
Yeah, if you've never been to a game.
They'll be very limited. Yeah. You'll have to have a promo code. You have to call it quick. Oh. So just keep that in mind.
Yeah, here's hoping to have a faster start to the season than they did last year.
They can come in better than the eighth seed.
Exactly.
And,
and
have a better draw. So, so far, it's hard to tell in the preseason, you know, that's been a mixed bag, but hockey's very fickle.
Yeah, hockey is very fickle.
So
I could give one last shout out though.
Go ahead, shout out.
You know, I'm a Houston boy, so Astros get the postseason underway on Thursday. So go Astros. Houston needs this. Texas strong. Everybody.
Big game
so,
tonight. Yeah, Colorado takes on Arizona for a one game.
Yep, in the playoffs. Yeah, for the wild card playoffs.
So that's a big game.
Be a good deal, but a
lot of good stuff going on in sports.
Yeah.
You got baseball coming to an end, football in the middle, hockey starting, basketball's right around the corner.
Yeah.
Well, with that being said, folks, we appreciate you joining us this week on the Extra Point. Well, we went really long, but we had lots to talk about. Good luck, everyone, and hope everybody has a great week. I'm here with Zach and Callie. Callie and Zach. Yeah. At, you can reach Zach at?
On Twitter, at Zach Birdsong, no spaces in between.
And at NewsGal27 on Twitter. And we both live tweet Franklin County and Tullahoma. So check us out Friday nights around 7 p.m. We're on Twitter doing the thing.
Yep.
Y'all fight on Twitter?
No. We're actually friends on Twitter for the most part.
It's just here in general.
Yeah.
All right. Thanks, folks. Have a good day.